Hi, I'm Tony, and welcome to Think Wealth TV. In this community, we're all about getting wealthy. If this is your first time watching, you might have noticed that the thumbnail is blue on this video is for educational videos. And we also have green thumbnails, which are for portfolio-related content, and we're also fully transparent. So when it comes to my portfolio, you guys can see what I'm actually investing in. Now, we also have orange thumbnails. That's more for opinion-based videos that I have. And we're also known in this channel for going deep into detail. So if this is your first time here, go ahead and hit the subscribe button. And while you're down there, hit the like, notification bell. And heck, you might as well share this video with everybody you know. Just do it all at once. Now, this video today, we're going to be talking about every single thing you need to know about ETFs. We're going to be going into a lot of detail, of course, talking about the pros, the cons, and we're going to go into visual examples of different types of uses you can use ETFs for. But we got to go over the basics first. We'll go into more complex stuff, starting with what an ETF is. If you Google what is an ETF, at least on my computer, what I get, the first thing that pops up is exchange traded fund. That probably doesn't help a lot of you guys. That's why we're going to jump into, I think, a better definition that explains it quite a bit better. NerdWallet, in my opinion, has a really good definition of what an ETF is. Yes, it's an exchange traded fund, just like the dictionary definition, but it says that it is a fund that can be traded on an exchange like a stock, hence the name. ETFs give you a way to buy and sell a basket of assets without having to buy all the components individually. To me, that's a great definition. It's from NerdWallet. That's right over here. That's one thing that's great about watching this channel, guys. If this is your first time here, I try to put everything all in one place so you don't have to Google multiple websites, look through different definitions to try to figure out which definition is the best, which one's maybe easiest to understand. For example, this one fits the bill perfectly. Generally, ETFs act in one of two ways. So either one, they act like an index, basically following the S&P 500, or maybe they're following the total stock market, or possibly following a certain sector such as utilities or REITs. Now, I like index investing, especially like in the S&P 500 or the total stock market. I think they're great ways to invest. I think they're very simple, and they also provide decent returns, which is nice. Now, the other type is ones that are funds. They're kind of like a mutual fund. Those seek to outperform the market in one way or another, such as they might be capital appreciation, you're trying to, let's say, beat the S&P 500, or they might try to be more for dividends, or they might try to be a more stable one, one that doesn't move as much, one that isn't as volatile, or they might try to protect yourself as a defensive play against downsides. So that way, when the stock market crashes, your stocks will be somewhat protected and they won't go down as much. So there's different ways to perform. No matter what type you go with, the nice thing about them is they trade just like stocks. So that means you can sell them quickly if you need to. Unlike a typical mutual fund, at least some of them are kind of hard to do that. You can't just sell them instantly on any given day like you could a stock. ETFs, you can. We just talked about index ETFs and fund ETFs. I wanted to talk about a couple other ones. We are going to talk more about bonds later. But to me, bonds fall under both index and funds, depending on if it's trying to get you the best corporate bonds possibly over different areas and fall under the fund, or if it's just like a total bond index or just nothing but long-term corporate bonds or things like that or short-term. And then there's also the industry ETFs. We talked about that already, the sector ones. We mentioned utilities and REITs. There's also commodities. That's one we wanted to talk about a little bit with you guys. Usually when people invest in commodities, it is usually crude oil or gold. In my opinion, I don't really do commodity ETFs. Crude oil, that's more futures they usually do. And buying futures, I'm not a big fan of myself. I guess maybe I just don't understand enough about it to trade futures. But I don't do futures personally. Nothing against people who do. And then when it comes to actual gold, though, I think personally, if you want to invest in gold and silver, it might not be a bad idea. I don't think it's so much as an investment as it is more of a way just to protect your money. More or less,
in my opinion, kind of protects against inflation. You might get some return on it. But if you're going to invest in gold or silver, I would invest in physical gold and silver, not stocks, not ETFs. That's just me personally. I don't know enough about currencies in general to invest in a currency ETFs. And I don't plan to learn more about currencies. I know they affect income statements to some degree. You know, when you have different currency fluctuations, they can affect how much money a business is making. But I don't understand enough about currencies from an investing standpoint to invest in. And to be honest, I haven't heard a lot of people invest in currency ETFs. I'm sure there's some people that do, but it's not very popular. But I just wanted to mention it. Inverse ETFs, this one we talked about, remember, protecting your stock market from downside. One way you could do this is with an inverse ETF. It's more of like a hedge, but this is something you want to do if the market's crashing, you feel like it's not at the bottom, that it's going to crash more. This is something you do short term, and you can make some good money if things work out. But I know in 2016, everybody thought there would be a crash. And if you bought inverse ETFs in 2016, you would have probably took a lot of losses, especially ones that are highly leveraged. There's ones that are like triple leveraged, things like that. You could lose some good money. So they're more of a short-term, not a long-term hedge. If you want more of a long-term hedge, that's where treasuries come in, U.S. treasuries, and also short-term corporate bonds. Now, if the market crashes, short-term corporate bonds will go down, but not as much as stocks. So me personally, I don't use these three ETFs. I would possibly, out of all three of these, use the inverse one, but I wouldn't put a lot of money into it. And maybe back in March, you know, when things first started crashing, you start having those massive sell-offs, then maybe put a little bit of money into an inverse ETF and you would have done pretty well. But you also got to know when to sell out of it too and how to take the profits off the table. So it's kind of a tricky game, I think. But I just wanted to mention those ones.
If you're considering investing in ETFs, something you need to be aware of is expense ratios. Now, when it comes to fund ETFs, those ones have higher expense ratios due to the fact that they're actively managed, meaning stocks are bought, sold, maybe switched out for other stocks on a regular basis. But the good news is you don't have to manage them. They're completely passive, just like index ETFs. Index ETFs, since they just follow an index, they usually have very small expense ratios. I like Vanguard myself because their expense ratios seem to be one of the smallest. But something to consider is, even though they're small and some investors might think they're irrelevant, they do still add up, especially the more money you have, they become a little bit more significant. But another thing that I don't personally hear people talk about is the fact that, in a sense, over the long term, they kind of compound in a certain degree. Those are potential losses that you're missing out on. Now, with that being said, I think ETFs are great. I own some of them, but it's just something to be aware of and consider when you're investing in them. Also, when it comes to investing in index ETFs, something that you might want to consider is, technically they're always going to slightly underperform the index that they're following due to that expense ratio. If you think about it, you have to pay that expense ratio regardless, and the index does not pay an expense ratio, only the ETF does. So therefore, you're going to underperform. Now, when it comes to ETFs, one thing that's kind of a pro for them is they do provide a lot of diversification, and they do provide a certain level of safety when it comes to the stock market. Now, your stocks can still go down, but at least you have some diversification to help mitigate the damages. Now, we are going to be going into more positives and negatives about ETFs, but first we're going to pull up some visual examples and uses for ETFs. But before we do that, something I would ask yourself as an investor is, one, whether you plan on being a dividend, an income, or growth. And really, I believe personally, you should be a little bit of each, depending on what kind of person you are, what style you prefer. I'm primarily a dividend investor, but I do invest some in growth, some for income. And when it comes to growth, for example, let's say you don't know which stocks to buy, ETFs can serve a good role in that degree, because you can actually just buy growth ETF. That way you have diversification, you don't have to try to figure out which individual stocks to buy. Now, something else I'd ask yourself too is how you plan on allocating your portfolio. Do you plan on being primarily all stocks, 100%? Or do you want 90% stocks, 10% bonds? it's a good idea to have some kind of plan of how you're going to invest before you start buying stocks or ETFs.
All right, guys. Two of the most popular, in my opinion anyways, ETFs is the VYM. It's the S&P 500 ETF, the too big to fail, and it's VTI, total stock market ETF. VYM has about 500 different stocks, a little bit over. VTI has a little over 3,000 different stocks. So there's quite a big difference in amount of holdings in each ETF. But they're essentially the same. If you look at VYM on the left, the sector allocations you can see over here. Same for VTI on the right. You can see the sector allocation. If you look at how they're allocated, they're pretty close to the same. You have 23.4 versus 24.08, 12.9 for financials, 12.72, and so on, communication over here, they're both 10%. You know, if we go over to healthcare, 14.95, 14.7, more or less they're the same. So you could kind of go with either or. It's spread out a smidge better on VTI, meaning it's more split between the different sectors. To further prove my point, if you look at the top 10 holdings, we still have VYM on the left, VTI on the right. They're exactly the same, in the same order, everything. So you're basically kind of buying the same ETF either way. If you buy VTI, it's basically about the same as just buying VYM, in my opinion. Somebody might think differently. I'm a firm believer in a too big to fail, so I lean more towards the VYM. But some people that say VTI, they'd say, well, you know, maybe the smaller caps are going to perform very well, which, yes, small caps can do very well. But they can also do terribly and go out of business. So I think they're going to kind of even each other out, especially when you have over 3,000 holdings. For the total holdings for each, you can see the VYM right now is in at 515. That's right here. And then VTI is actually sitting at 3,500 different stocks. VTI does have quite a bit more stocks, but again, you see the way the weighing goes for the top 10 versus the top 10 over here. They're pretty close. Again, you're almost buying the same ETF. You really go either way. Now, I do think both the VYM and VTI are considered growth, at least for me. I consider them a growth. And reason being is that on average, at least for the S&P 500, there's more information on that than there is the total stock market. The S&P on average, we use a calculator for 100 years, has returned 10.5%. If you look at the last 30 years, it's 10.34. The reason I bring up the last 30 years is because I think the 30 years might be a little bit more relevant because of the fact that usually when you talk to different people, they talk about how long they plan on investing. Usually they'll say at least 30 years. So therefore, I believe 30 years is a good estimate to use. I'm primarily a dividend investor, but I still see the VYM more as a growth. The dividend yield is 1.82. I believe the price that I bought the shares at, I'm yielding 2%, maybe 2.1%. So I'm getting a little bit better. But even if you look at VTI, you're only getting 1.61. So you're getting a little bit less form of dividend yield from VTI in comparison to VYM. So me personally, I like the VYM a little bit better. Either one's good. This isn't meant to be a comparison between the two. It's just to give you guys some examples of different ETFs people use. Both VYM and VTI also have an expense ratio of 0.03. So it is a very small expense ratio, and they're both the same when it comes to that. Another ETF that I own is SPHD. On the left, we still have the VYM. On the right, we have SPHD. We're going to again look at the sector allocation. And if you look over here, you have 3% in utilities, 2.79% in real estate, both very low. I think real estate, especially now being beaten down, is a great time to invest. And utilities, they don't seem to be performing that well, surprisingly. I think it's a good idea to have some utility exposure. So me personally, I like a little bit more than 2.79% for real estate and 3.13 for utilities. That's the reason I invest in SPHD. Utilities is 16.84. Real estate is 14.04. Something I want to bring out about SPHD too, a lot of people seem to not like SPHD right now, but in the past, a lot of people were happy with SPHD, and they haven't been performing that well recently, and they're considered a low volatility stock. So they say that basically it's a marketing scam, that they're not actual low volatility. Well, real estate's been doing bad, so that's why that's down. Technology's been doing phenomenal, but technology's only 11% versus over here 24%. So that's something to take into consideration that, yes, if you look at technology and S&P 500, it's quite a bit higher allocation versus the technology and SPHD. So, of course, if you're actually looking at the stock allocation, SPHD is going to perform worse than the S&P 500. Now, if utilities have a humongous boom and real estate too, and they're both going through the roof in prices, we are in a recession right now. Let's say technology starts taking a hit really bad and it starts going down and down and down. The S&P is going to take a big hit. SPHD is going to do great. Now, if that was to happen, would that mean that now S&P 500 is a terrible ETF and nobody should invest in S&P 500? No, that just means that technology took a hit and S&P 500 had a lot of allocation towards technology. So, of course, that's going to take the hit. It's very important to look at not just how it's performing recently, but how it's allocated. Now, if you don't like utilities and you don't like real estate, then you probably shouldn't be investing in SPHD. You should look at the way they're held. 7.16% energy, you might not like that. You might like that the S&P 500 is only 2.54% in energy. There's nothing wrong with liking one ETF more than the other. It's just, I don't think you should bash an ETF without looking at the allocation and seeing why it's performing bad. I was a little disappointed that SPHD took a tank, but to be honest, I didn't buy SPHD until it took the tank. I think it's still a great ETF, even though it's down. I do think it's going to recover, and I'm going to do very well in capital appreciation and when it comes to dividends. SPHD is actively managed, so its expense ratio is 0.3%. So it's about a third of a percent versus S&P 500, which was 0.03%. So it's technically 10 times higher when compared to the VU. I'm pulling up two other popular ETFs. They're both Vanguard again. I'm not sponsored by Vanguard. But when it comes to the one on the left, that's VYM, that's Vanguard High Dividend Yield ETF. I own that one personally. This is for dividends. So I am primarily a dividend investor. I like this ETF myself. It's very well-rounded. In my opinion, yes, it is a little bit low on consumer cyclical and real estate. That's why I have the SPHD. And also utilities aren't bad at 9.19, but I wanted more REIT exposure, so I went with SPHD. There's also VNQ, which is Vanguard's real estate ETF. This one's all real estate. So if you wanted, some people, they might want maybe 80% in the VU, and they want 10% in VNQ, and they might put the other 10% in bonds, which we'll go over briefly too. Something else to take consideration in, we talked about the sector allocation. We look at dividends. Now, again, I'm a dividend investor, so this might not be important to you if you're not a dividend investor, but VYM has a dividend yield of 4%, VNQ 3.71. In my opinion, I expect a good dividend yield when it comes to REITs. 3.71 for ETF that holds nothing but REITs, to me, is a little bit low, especially since they've been being down really bad currently. So I don't like the dividend yield on VNQ. That's just me personally. I like VYM. Another thing that's interesting is VYM, the expense ratio is 0.06. And VNQ, the expense ratio is 0.12. So VYM has half the expense ratio when compared to VNQ. So VYM, lower expense ratio, higher dividend yield, and it's more equally weighed when it comes to sector allocation. So to me, that's why I went with VYM, and that's why I chose SPHD over VNQ. It was mostly the way it was allocated, how it was spread out really nicely, but also quite a bit bigger yield. Now when it comes to bonds, let's say you wanted a 10% allocation to bonds, some people really enjoy BND. That's another Vanguard fund, but it's a total bond market. So that has a little bit of everything. If you look at the holdings, you have government bonds, U.S. treasuries, and then you have corporate bonds and so on inside of the fund. You can look at the top 10 holdings. As you can see, most of them are treasuries. When it comes to bonds, two of the bond ETFs that I like the most personally is VGSH and VCSH. Currently, as the time of making this video, interest rates are near 0%. If interest rates go up, the short-term treasuries and corporate bonds won't really get affected that much. Long-term and intermediate are more affected by interest rates. So generally speaking, when interest rates are high, that's the time to get long-term corporate bonds and long-term treasuries. When they're low, generally you'll go short-term on treasuries and short-term on corporate bonds.
One big positive when it comes to investing in ETFs is that they're available on Robinhood. So if you guys have not signed up for Robinhood, there's an affiliate link in the description below. We can both get a free stock. I don't know what you guys are waiting for. But all joking aside, there is another negative when it comes to ETFs. And that being is that when you buy an ETF, especially an index ETF, you're investing in both the winners and the losers. To avoid buying the losers, there's another advantage to ETFs, and that is they're basically a free research tool, meaning you can look up an ETF, and you can view their holdings, and you can see all the different stocks that's inside that ETF. That way you can avoid the losers and buy the winners. Now, winner isn't necessarily a stock that's way up in price that might come coming down quick tomorrow. It's stock that you feel comfortable buying, a stock that you believe in, a stock that you're not going to lose sleep over. Something you want to avoid is maybe something you're unsure of, something that you're worried about, a stock that you might lose sleep over. Those would be the losers. So avoid those, buy the winners. And something else is if you look at their holdings, they're usually weighed by market cap, meaning the first stock would usually be the largest company, the largest market cap. And as the list goes down, they get smaller and smaller. That's how they allocate their money. They allocate more money towards the larger market caps. I like to do the same. I like to invest more money in larger market caps and less in smaller market caps. So I do like to invest in small, medium, and large market caps and megas and possibly some micros, but I allocate money according to the market cap. Bigger companies, I'm going to invest more in. Even if you guys are not going to invest in ETFs, they do provide that research regardless, which is nice. Me personally, I invest in individual stocks and ETFs, and when it comes to my individual stocks, so I like to look at my sector allocation. Sometimes in certain areas, they're too small and I need to add positions. I use SPYDER ETFs. They have an ETF for every single sector. So the nice thing about it is whatever sector I need to add stocks to, I'll look up the actual sector that I need, and I'll pick the winners from that individual sector by looking up the holdings. And I'll disregard the losers like we talked about earlier. Remember guys though, if you're going to invest in ETFs, just be mindful of the expense ratios and check out their sector allocation, how they're weighed in each sector, and also look at their holdings. Now, ETFs are very beneficial and I believe they can help out most people. Even if you don't plan to invest in ETFs, like we just talked about, use that research. Now, I know this is a lot of information guys, but we're trying to give you, hopefully, a better understanding of ETFs from watching this. And if you did manage to stick through this video, I don't know why you haven't subscribed already. Click the like button, notification bell. There's more content like this to come. And remember, as always, guys, think wealth.